أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إن الحمد لله وبه نستعين والصلاة والسلام على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. First of all, I just want to thank people for thank you all for inviting me. This is sort of introductory talk because hadith is often, I remember when I first became Muslim and I started learning about hadith, I always would ask questions about hadith and people would say, you know, brother, don't even think about it. It's too complicated. Don't even try. It's just such a deep science. You'll never understand it. Don't even think about it. So I said, okay, well, I guess I shouldn't learn about hadith. And then when I went to graduate school, alhamdulillah, there were actually some older students who were studying hadith, and they sort of introduced me to how to start learning about hadith and studying with teachers and things like that, and reading sort of introductory books. And I started learning, and I found it's actually not that difficult a science. In fact, hadith is a very common sense science. It's a very common sense tradition, and something that Muslims should be very proud of. And I have no problem saying this. I say it very, very confidently as a scholar that the hadith tradition in Islam is one of the biggest accomplishments in human intellectual history. It's just a tremendous accomplishment in terms of its breadth and its depth and its complexity and its internal consistency. And it's something that Muslims should be very proud of, and something Muslims should be happy to learn about, even if they're just starting out, because as the famous Chinese saying says, a journey of 1,000 miles starts with a single step. So hopefully this will just be a very short introduction to some of the history of hadith collection and the purposes of hadith in Islamic civilization. The first question is, what is a hadith? Very simple question. What is a hadith? Hadith is a statement of the Prophet, alayhi salatu wasalam, a communication about an action the Prophet did, alayhi salatu wasalam, or something that was done in his presence to which he did not object. Something done in his presence to which he did not object. We'll talk about examples of these in a second. I think we've all know examples of sayings of the Prophet. For example, إِنَّمَا الْعَمَالُ بِالنِّيَّاتِ. All deeds are judged by intentions. Right? Things that the Prophet did. How did he pray? Right? Reports about how he prayed, about how he fasted, about how he sat, about how he drank. Right? Things that were done in his presence. That people ate lizard in his presence. And he didn't say that this is wrong. If he didn't say it's wrong, it must be right. So these are the three types of hadiths. Sayings, actions, and things done in his presence to which he did not object. Every hadith consists of two things. It consists of an isnad and the metin. What is the isnad? The isnad is the chain of transmission for that metin. The metin is the actual text of the hadith. So those examples I just gave, for example, innamal a'malu binniyat, all deeds are judged by intentions. This is the metin of the hadith, the actual statement of the Prophet. Or if I said, the Prophet used to walk in this way, that would be the metin of the hadith, describing what the Prophet did. The isnad is the chain of transmission by which we know that hadith. So for example, the hadith of all deeds are judged by intentions is narrated, let's say we'll take the Muwatta of Imam Malik, from Malik, from Yahya bin Sa'id al-Ansari, from Muhammad ibn Ibrahim, from Alqama ibn Waqqas, from Omar ibn al-Khattab, who heard the Prophet say, all deeds are judged by intentions. So that's the isnad. And here I have some just examples of some hadiths that come from major hadith collections, Sunni hadith collections. This is from the famous Sahih of al-Bukhari, the Sahih of Muhammad ibn Ismail al-Bukhari. He says, it was narrated to us by Yusuf ibn Musa. It was narrated to us. Now, Yusuf ibn Musa is saying, it was narrated to us by Abu Usama, who says, it was narrated to me by Al-A'mash, from Khaythama, from the companion Adi ibn Hatim, who said that the Messenger of God, may God's peace and blessings be upon him, said, there is not one amongst you except that he will be spoken to directly by his Lord, with no translator or any barrier separating them. In other words, on the Day of Judgment. So this is a very important hadith because it tells us actually about something that's going to happen on the Day of Judgment. It means that we're all going to come into direct contact with God on the Day of Judgment. Right? Here's a second hadith from a very famous Sunni hadith collection, the Sunan of Abu Dawood al-Sijistani. He says, it was narrated to us by Muhammad ibn Dawood ibn Sufyan, who says it was narrated to us by Yahya ibn Hassan, who said it was narrated to us by Sulaiman ibn Musa, who said it was narrated to us by Ja'far ibn Sa'd, We said it was narrated to me by Khubayb ibn Sulayman from his father, from the companion Samara ibn Jundub, who said in a speech, he was giving a speech, "Indeed the Messenger of God, may the peace and blessings of God be upon him, would order us to pay a charity on things we were preparing for sale." So this is very important because it helps us know about zakat. So if I'm preparing something for sale, let's say I'm producing something that I'm going to sell, like a saddle, let's say, or a saddle blanket, right? Maybe I'm almost finished, I'm going to get it ready to sell. I actually have to pay charity tax on these things. Or these things, the potential income, let's say. Actually, exactly how this, now that I think about it, exactly how this hadith would be interpreted is very complicated. I don't want to get into that because I know I'll make a mistake. This is from a less famous hadith collection. Somebody who died later than Bukhari and Abu Dawood. Someone named Abu al-Qasim Sulaiman al-Tabarani. He died in 971 of the Common Era, 360 of the Hijri calendar. He said it was narrated to us by Ahmed ibn Mansur al-Jindisapuri. It was narrated to him by Ali ibn Harb. And it was reported to him by Ash'ath ibn Attaf, from Abdullah ibn Habib, from a Sha'bi, from the companion Jabir ibn Abdullah, that the Messenger of God bought a camel from me and then let me ride it back into the city. So this hadith is interesting in two ways. One, it tells us about the character of the Prophet, which is that he's very generous and conscientious of other people's needs. And second, it says that you can sell something to somebody and then you can actually use it after that, you know, maybe with that person's permission. There's nothing wrong with that, right? So it has ethical implications, it also has practical legal implications. These are just a few examples of hadiths the Prophet said. Another important thing to remember when we talk about hadith is that if you imagine I say something in this lecture, right? And then all of you leave the room and you all go back to your homes and your friends and your families, and you tell them about something I said. There's going to be a lot of different versions of what I said. Right? Let's say I say, always be nice to your mother. Right? Usman can go home and say, Dr. Jonathan said that it's very important to be nice to your mother. And Moiz can say, he said, it's part of a Muslim's behavior to be nice to your mother. Right? So you actually get different versions of the same report